ज्ञानतिमिरन्धस्य ज्ञानाञ्जनाशलाकया चक्षुरुन्मिलितं येन तस्मै श्रीगुरवे नमः श्रीचैतन्यमनोभीष्टं स्थापितं येन भूतले स्वयं रूपा कदा मह्यं ददाति स्वपदान्तिकं वन्देऽहं श्रीगुरु श्रीयुतपदकमलं श्रीगुरुं वैष्णवांश श्रीरूपं साग्रजातां सहगना रघुनाथान्वितं तं सजीवं साद्वैतं सावधूतं परिचनासहितं श्रीकृष्णचैतन्यदेवं श्रीराधाकृष्णपादां सहगणा ललिता श्रीविशाखान्वितांश नमाओं विष्णुपादाय कृष्णप्रेष्ठाय भूतले श्रीमते भक्तिवेदान्तस्वामिनिति नामिने नमस्ते सरस्वती देवे गौरवाणी प्रचारिणे निर्विशेषशून्यवादी पाश्चताय देशतारिणे नमो महावदन्याय कृष्णप्रेमपदाय ते कृष्णाय कृष्णचैतन्यनाम्ने गौतुसे नमः वंचकल्पतरुभ्यश्च कृपासिन्धुभ्यैव च पतितानां पावनेभ्यो वैष्णवेभ्यो नमो नमः हे कृष्ण करुणा सिन्धु दीनबन्धु जगत्पते गोपेश गोपिका कांत राधाकांत नमस्तते तप्त कांचन गौरांगी श्री राधे वृंदावनेश्वरी वृषभानुसुते देवी प्रणमामि हरि प्रिये जय श्री कृष्ण चैतन्य प्रभु नित्यानंद श्री अद्वैत गदाधा शिवासादि गौभक्तवृंद हरे कृष्णा 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 हरे 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 राम 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 हरे हरे सो थैंक यू वंस अगेन फॉर जॉइनिंग अस सो विदाउट फर्दर डिले विल बिगिन विद अवर चैप्टर वन ऑफ भगवद गीता जस्ट टू मेक अ पॉइंट क्लियर Some of you might have thought about it. Bhagavad Gita ko 18 adhyay mein divide kara hua hai. Aisa nahi tha jab Arjun aur Krishna ke beech mein samvad chal raha tha. To Arjun bolte the, Bhagwan, chapter 1 ka ant hota hai. Chapter shuru ki shuruaat karte hain. So question comes from where did this chapters, concept of chapters came? This is all done by our acharyas, maybe Vyasadeva. I don't remember exactly details of it, but it's done by our acharyas, where just to simplify the subject matter, just imagine, when we begin to read this, you know, when we'll summarize the first chapter, you'll understand how helpful it had been for us, ki ye jo around 42 verses hain, they have been clubbed under a single title, which is Observing the Armies. Agar yahan pe 700 shlok hote, bina sections ke, bina clarification how the theme is flowing through, it could have been very difficult. Even itne sections banane ke baad bhi difficult hota hai. Bina section ke to so kya difficult hota hai. Isliye this book has been, or this conversation has been classified into 18, I would call it as a section, not a chapter. The reason I am using the word section over a chapter, just because for me, the meaning of a chapter always had been, ki agar koi chapter khatam hota hai, is the end of the story. And another chapter begins means something new begins. And when you call off a section, section is something which are interlinked, but there is a different tone to the message. So although we call it as a chapter, but if in case you have the meaning of a chapter just like I have, then see it in a context of section, because it's a conversation. It is interrelated, just like you and I would speak. And if you ask me a question or I ask you a question, it's a dialogue which is happening between two people. And this is how I would like to help you to bring out this experience, where you can experience the dialogue between two living people. There are a lot of misinterpretations about Bhagavad Gita, and the foremost of the misinterpretation is, Many authors claim Kurukshetra is no, Kurukshetra actually doesn't exist. Pandavas did not exist, Kauravas did not exist, Krishna did not exist or does not exist. Kurukshetra is nothing but this body. Pandavas are nothing but the five senses. Like that, many authors give misinterpretation of Bhagavad Gita. And that's the reason for the level one course we thought we'll try to emphasize on how we can feel the living conversation between two personalities, a bhakta and a bhagavan. So with that, to make it further easy for us, we'll use acronyms. So you may remember how this whole chapter is divided. So many devotees who have a scholarly mindset, they came together and they further divided the chapters to make it more simple, to make it more simple for us in a form of an acronym. So now these 42 verses are divided in an acronym or in the form of doubt. D stands for Dhritarashtra and Duryodhan. Now these are the things for which I have given you a pen and a notebook that you want to note it down, just to remind you. Because that's the reason I didn't include these notes in the notebook. So D stands for Dhritarashtra and Duryodhan, where the verse number 1 to 12 will focus about these two personalities. O stands for ominous result, verse number 13 to 20, and so forth as the discussion goes. I'll be talking about each of the section when we begin. So let's begin our today's discussion with the... We'll be coming back to those themes again. I hope at least if you remember nothing or not, at least remember the acronym. So much, agar raat ko 2 baje main aapko phone karke puchta hoon, chapter 1 ka acronym kya hai? Raat ko sote sote bolna chahiye, doubt. Itne dhyan se seekh lo. It's easy now. So if you imagine, if you get all these acronyms, now you know the whole 18 chapters, the high level view, you know what are the main themes. And this is said to be the best self-help book. If you ever have any problem in your life and if you need any particular help, you know which particular chapter. And depending on how well you have learned it, then you know which particular section to go and find it out. So, I guess I have a verse written there only. Let's begin with chapter 1, verse number 1. Dhritarashtravacha Dharma Kshetre Kuru Kshetre Samveta Yusavaha Mamakha Pandavas Chaiva Kimmakurvata Sanjaya. We can't expect a better and a more auspicious beginning of a sacred literature like Bhagavad Gita than with Dhritarashtravacha. The biggest criminal, the biggest conspirator because of which the Mahabharata war happened. How interesting it is that Bhagavad Gita begins with Dhritarashtravacha. Why Dhritarashtra? Why not Krishna Vacha? Why not Arjuna Vacha? I would request you, when you're, we won't be reciting all the verses of the chapter, but we at least would read translation. One thing you will notice that in different verse, very interesting. Just like you are talking to someone who is very rich, a rich person. So you may say, aap kitne dhani ho, or dhanwan ho. Which means that he has a lot of wealth, and you are indicating something. Similarly, in the conversation between Krishna and Arjuna, sometimes Krishna would call Arjuna as, you know, Gudakesh, conqueror of sleep. Sometimes Arjuna would call Krishna as Govinda, Madhusudana, Partha Sarthi, and different names. Rarely you will see Arjuna addressing Krishna as Krishna. Very rarely. And very rarely you will see Krishna addressing Arjuna as Arjuna. And so rarely you would see Sanjaya addressing Krishna as Krishna. Nowhere Krishna says Krishna Uvacha. Sanjaya says Bhagavan Uvacha. Now why he says Bhagavan Uvacha, that we'll see in the second chapter, where Bhagavan begins to speak. In the first chapter, Bhagavan is just an audience. He's just listening to it. So we'll not talk about it, we'll talk then. So just to give a little background, I guess, I don't know if you, probably we discussed last time. This conversation right now is being retold by Sanjaya to Dhritarashtra. Alright? This is coming in Mahabharata. And Sanjaya is telling what is happening on the battlefield as inquired by Dhritarashtra in the very first verse. Now, what is Dhritarashtra means? Dhrit means very determined. Dhrit ka matlab hota hai bahut hi attached hona bhi. Rashtra ka matlab kya hota hai? Nation. Sounds like an everyday politician. Right? A common day politician that we know of. Dhritarashtra. A person who is so attached to his throne, so attached, even he does not deserve it, still he wants it. If it does not belong to him, he would forcefully acquire it. And that's the reason Bhagavad Gita begins with Dhritarashtra Vacha. Somewhere, Dhritarashtra Vacha, or this word, is addressing our material attachments. And that's where the journey of Bhagavad Gita is from material attachments represented by Dhritarashtra, and it ends with spiritual attachment represented by Arjuna at the end of Bhagavad Gita, where Krishna says, Sarva Dharman Parityaja. My dear Arjuna, give up all false religions, surrender unto me. And then Krishna says, I have spoken whatever I had to tell you. Now you do whatever you want to do. And then Arjuna says, my dear Lord, I will follow whatever you say. A material attachment to a spiritual attachment is the journey of Bhagavad Gita. And if somebody hears it patiently, just like we said, it is not that if everyone reads or hears Bhagavad Gita, they will be transformed. Krishna tried his best. Sanjaya tried his best. Dhritarashtra itna dheet tha. 700 shlok sunne ke baad, Bhagwan Shri Krishna ke darshan lene ke baad bhi usme antar असर नहीं आया, परिवर्तन नहीं आया. और परिवर्तन क्यों नहीं आया, उसका कारण हमने पिछले हफ्ते बात करी थी. सो जस्ट टू गिव यू लिटिल बैकग्राउंड, वैदिक नेम्स, जो वैदिक संस्कृति के अनुसार जो नाम होते हैं, दे आर नॉट लाइक टॉमी, पॉपी, यू नो, सम टिंकी पिंकी लाइक दैट, यू नो, द मॉडर्न डे नेम्स. देयर आर नो ऑफेंस टू एनी नेम्स, आई एम जस्ट शेयरिंग. यू नो, ऑफन टाइम व्हेन आई मीट समबडी, आई आस्क देम, व्हाट्स द मीनिंग ऑफ योर नेम. पापा से पूछो, मम्मी से पूछो, is a general response they give. And I don't take a risk asking their parents. They would definitely get offended. Don't ask the name. We don't know also. We just found it on Google search. So, for example, Yudhishthir. What is the meaning of word Yudhishthir? Yudh means fight, war. Yudhishthir, sthir means study. The meaning of the word Yudhishthir is someone who is steady, who is fixed, who is unwavering in any calamity, as severe as the war. That is the meaning of Yudhishthir. And Yudhishthir showed it by his personality. That's the reason this name was given to him. Arjun. The word Arjun means spotless character. You know, we can go into the details and the history of it. That's not the subject matter, so I'm giving synopsis. And we remember how Arjuna, when he had gone to meet Indra, a heavenly damsel had approached Arjuna and she said, why don't we enjoy together? Arjuna, looking at the most beautiful lady, he said, my dear mother, I have never seen you with that intention. That's the reason Arjuna is termed to have a spotless character, and that's what he represented. Dronacharya. Dron, a cup, a leaf cup. So this Dronacharya refers to a person who was born on a leaf cup. So like that, when we come across the names, I'm just giving you some ideas. So when you read Bhagavad Gita, again and again, different names will be referred for Arjun and Krishna. For some, I may, if time permits, give you meaning. For others, read the purport. Prabhupada talks about it. The psychology why Arjuna at a certain place calling Krishna as Govinda. At the end of first chapter, you will see Krishna address Arjuna address Krishna as Govinda. Now why he address Arjuna, why Arjuna address Krishna as Govinda? Govinda means one who gives pleasure to the senses. So Arjun वहाँ पे कृष्ण को गोविंदा इसलिए कहते हैं, हे भगवान, मैं युद्ध नहीं लड़ना चाहता, तुम्हारा नाम है गोविंदा, मैं अभी एजिटेटेड हूँ, तुम्हारा होमवर्क है मेरा सारा एजिटेशन खत्म करना. So there Prabhupada writes in a purport, that's not the meaning of Govinda. He is a pleasure giver, but only what he thinks that you deserve, to only that much, not you can demand from him. Bhima. Bhima means something who, someone who performs Herculean task. You know, another name for Bhima is Vrakodara, who eats a lot like that. And another protagonist, as they say, or the star personality is दुर्योधन, योधन मीन्स, योधन मीन्स वॉर और फाइटिंग, दुर मीन्स वेरी डिफिकल्ट, सो दुर्योधन मीन्स समवन हु इज वेरी डिफिकल्ट टू फाइट विद, विच मीन्स ही इज वेरी वेरी पावरफुल. आई हैव हर्ड फ्रॉम मेनी, I have not read it, but I have heard from devotees within ISKCON that actually it was Duryodhan was Dhritarashtra did not name his son as Duryodhan. He was named as Suyodhan. Suyodhan means a great fighter, great person, and Dhan means Yodhan means fighter. So earlier his name was, he was a great fighter, but because of his bad association, primarily with Shakuni and his dear father, he later on came to be known as Duryodhan. So just a background, what the name means about. Let's come back to verse number one, text number one again, Dhritarashtra Vacha. So if you see, Bhagavad Gita opens with a syllable Dha. Now I want you, each one of you, to go to the last shloka of Bhagavad Gita, 18th chapter, verse number 78. Please read out the last syllable of Bhagavad Gita. 18 chapter 78th verse, the last syllable. What is the last syllable of Bhagavad Gita? Not mama, ma. Mama means two syllables. So Dhritarashtra, the first syllable with which Bhagavad Gita opens is dha, and with which Bhagavad Gita ends is ma. Now what is between dha and ma is the content of 700 verses. There is something invisible, hidden between this dha and ma. Now, what is invisible? We all know. There are 700 verses. But there is a very succinct or clear message between these two syllables. If you and I have to read it by ourselves, we will not get it. And that's the reason we need purpose by our acharyas. And between this dha and ma, the syllable which comes is ra. And if you combine these three together, what it becomes? Dharma. So all through all every single verse of Bhagavad Gita, Krishna is trying to teach us the true meaning of dharma. Whichever verse you read, there is that hidden meaning about dharma. Now question arises, what is dharma? Anyone? What is dharma? Very nice. Duty. Very good answer. Anyone else? Constitutional nature of something. All of you look like quite learned. You have at least learned something about Bhagavad Gita. Huh? Religious principles? Do's and don'ts? Nobody is saying religion. I'm so surprised. Okay. Dharma. Again, open your Bhagavad Gita. As I said, you have to bring your Bhagavad Gita. We'll be referring. Go to page number 17. Introduction. Introduction, page number 17. Srila Prabhupada very beautifully defines what is dharma. Do we have a cordless mic? We can just give it so somebody can read it out if they found it. You see dharma, when Sanatan Goswami, you see that paragraph? So before that paragraph, you see on the sixth last line of a paragraph above it, there is a word written dharma. Anyone able to find it? Okay, please give the mic to Prabhu. I forgot your name, Prabhu. Abhijit. Abhijit, please read it out. What is the meaning of dharma?
Hello. Dharma refers to that which is constantly existing with a particular object.
Which means dharma refers to inseparable identity, which cannot be separated. So if with that understanding, if I ask you, what is the dharma of sugar? What is the dharma of sugar then? You cannot separate sweetness from sugar. What is the dharma of salt? The saltiness. What is the dharma of water? Liquidity. What is the dharma of jiva? Make money. What is the dharma of jiva? So surprising. You knew what is the dharma of sugar. You knew dharma of salt. There were no contradictions, no multiple answers. No, everyone have their own answer. What is dharma of jiva? To serve Lord, okay. What else? Service. Please read ahead. You'll find out what is the dharma.
We conclude that there is heat and light along with the fire. Without heat and light, there is no meaning to the word fire. Similarly, we must discover the essential part of the living being, that part which is his constant companion. That constant companion is his is eternal quality, and that eternal quality is his eternal
religion. So now question comes, what is that eternal quality of a living entity? इसीलिए प्रभुपाद नेक्स्ट पैराग्राफ में सनातन गोस्वामी वन ऑफ अवर प्रोमिनेंट आचार्यस ही कोट्स हिज कॉन्वर्सेशन विद श्री चैतन्य महाप्रभु एंड सिमिलर काइंड ऑफ क्वेश्चन इज आस्क्ड बाय सनातन गोस्वामी टू बाय टू श्री चैतन्य महाप्रभु माय डियर लॉर्ड व्हाट इज माय धर्म और व्हाट इज माय इटर्नल कॉन्स्टिट्यूशनल पोजिशन प्लीज रीड आउट अहेड
व्हेन सनातन गोस्वामी asked Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu about the Swaroop of every living being. The Lord replied that the Swaroop or constitutional position of the living being is the rendering of service to the Supreme Personality of Godhead.
So, it's not Seva. It's Seva to the Supreme Personality of Godhead. And we'll skip reading ahead. Prabhupada does analysis of the statement. And he says, we can very easily analyze that Seva is our eternal identity. And Prabhupada says, just like, you know, a husband does service to his family. You know, the son serves his parents. And each one of you are serving the government, serving some company, somebody. Not only human beings, even you see other living entities serving. Don't we see all this food chain? We know the concept of food chain. If any of the living organisms are missing out of the food chain, we may not survive. Which means all living beings are interconnected and they have a role to play. Just like a tree does so much service. Even a pig does service to the community by eating stool and other filthy things. So every living entity, jiva, I'm not addressing humans. And that's what Krishna is going to talk about, difference between jiva and what a human being in that sense. So every living entity's constitutional position is to serve. Do we agree? Do we recognize that? Yes or no? Any doubts on it? Now, to build a faith that how our constitutional position is to serve the Supreme Personality of Godhead is a part of our discussion through Bhagavad Gita. That will do that. Questions we'll take at the end. You can write it down. So, you know, we don't at least skip out the discussion. Now, what is the difference between religion and dharma then? Because dharma gets translated into religion, right? In English. What does religion mean? If you look back into your Oxford dictionary or any English dictionary, the word religion is defined as something called as an institutionalized faith. Institutionalized faith means some group of people come together and they decide to follow something in what they believe. And for that, they make certain rules and regulations. And that's the reason all these religions, no offense meant for anyone, but even Hinduism, Islam, Sikhism, Judaism, Christianity, dharma, can dharma be ever changed? Can our dharma from seva turn into a saltiness or sweetness? No. Dharma is constant. But do people change religion? Yes or no? So that's the reason these religions represent man-made identifications. They do not represent our true nature. And when you read Srila Prabhupada Purport, he very strongly talks about it. Do not waste your life just simply identifying yourself that I am so-and-so, belonging to so-and-so sect, because I am born into that. There's nothing wrong if you believe in it, but we are more than that. That's the idea about it. Okay, let's go back to first verse, because it's too important. First verse of Bhagavad Gita indicates a particular mindset of Dhritarashtra. If you look back into the verse, he says, dharma kshetre kuru kshetre samaveta yusavaha mamaka pandavas chaiva kim akurvata sanjaya. Doesn't seem like a pretty stupid question Dhritarashtra is asking? He's asking, my sons, mamaka, Pandavas, the sons of Pandu, what did they do in the battlefield? By India, Pakistan, agar cricket ground pe khadi hai, to koi kabaddi thoda khelega. It's meant for playing cricket. And he is the orchestrator of this whole cricket match or the battle. And he's asking Sanjaya, what did my sons and the sons of Pandu do on the battlefield? Well, it sounds stupid, but it's not that stupid. He has a great meaning behind that question. And that's the reason the very first word which he uses here is Dharma Kshetre. Dharma Kshetre Kurukshetra. See, Kurukshetra is the land where the war is happening. But Dhritarashtra ko usko Dharma Kshetra kehne ki kya avashyakta padi? Now, Kurukshetra had been a land of Dharma. It is the same place where Parshuram performed years of penances. It's the same place where people would go. Even today, they go and perform many, many pious activities. It's a land of Dharma. Now, when Dhritarashtra says Dharma Kshetre, actually, he's insecure. He's expressing his fear here. And what is his fear here? And that fear is, just like if you go to, you know, to a bar where there is a rock music or a very passionate music is being played. How gentlemanly, I'm not saying they're not gentlemen. In other words, how sober you are, you would be pushed into doing some tandav there, yes? I mean, tandav means, I mean the dance that they do, you know? So you'll be pushed into doing that dance, isn't it? Which means the place has an impact. We all agree? So Dharma Kshetra Kurukshetra, when Dhritarashtra said Kurukshetra being a land of piety, Dhritarashtra got scared. Aisa na ho, kahi mere putra, us pious land ke prabhav mein aakar, Duryodhan ka man badal jaye. Now Dhritarashtra is just like a mafia don. You know what's in mafia don? He does not come in front, but he has his players who are enacting his, you know, or who is following his whatever task is given. So Duryodhan is just like a puppet in the hand of Dhritarashtra. And that's how he plays his game. And that's the reason. See, among asking anything and everything, he's asking what did they do. He's not asking about the well-being of his sons. If he had any affection, he could have asked, are my sons okay? And if he had any affection for the sons of Pandu, he could also have asked, are the sons of Pandu doing okay? Nowhere he asked that question. He asked, kya chal raha hai bhai? Kabaddi, I mean the yudh shuru hua nahi hua. It was just like that for them. First thing. And second thing, he hoped. Just like an impious person gets affected in the association of a saintly people or in the saintly area. Just like you visit, you know, for example, let's say ISKCON temple. How many of you have visited ISKCON temple? How many of you feel some amount of positive energy there? Yes? The place has its impact. So now he thought, second fear or second, not fear, thought he had, Pandus or Pandu's sons are already pious. If somebody is already pious, what else can he do? Maybe under the influence of piety, he may decide to not fight in the war. Again, Dhritarashtra was worried. Itne saalo se wait kar raha hun. Kitni baar inko maarne ka prayatna kara hai. Ab finally aa gaye hain. Agar in logon ne yahan decide kara nahi ladenge, phir chale jayenge. But the fear of Pandavas would remain in my life. So here, by saying Dharma Kshetre Kurukshetre, Dhritarashtra makes his intention all clear. I am the mafia. I am the gangster. I am playing the dice here. I am the one who is making the decision. And why he is making the decision? Because Duryodhan isn't the king. Duryodhan Raja nahi tha. Raja kaun tha? Dhritarashtra. Daswe din jab Bhishma Pitama ka vad hua tha, or jab Bhishma Pitama decided to give up his life when he lied down on the bed of arrows. Us samay, us sham ko Bhishma Pitama Duryodhan ko message dete hain. And he calls Duryodhan to meet him personally. At that point of time, Bhishma Pitama tells Duryodhan, Duryodhan, there is no use of fighting this war. Don't you see who's standing on the other side? Is Krishna, the supreme personality of God, and who you also know is a supreme person. Even I, who could never be defeated in the war, even I, who could not be killed by anyone, have been defeated. Do you still think that you can win the war? And when Duryodhan heard this, he fell silent. And Bhishma Pitama understood that he is not going to change. Jaisa baap, waisa beta. To baap hati tha, to beta bhi waisa tha. Just like the father is insecure, Now, let's see the insecurity of Duryodhan from verse number 2. So from verse number 2, Sanjaya begins to speak. And from verse number 2 to verse number 12, Duryodhan's diplomacy and Duryodhan's insecurity gets highlighted. Now, important question comes. Sanjaya batana shuru karte hain ki battlefield pe kya chal raha hai. So you may ask a question. Bhai Sanjaya ne pehle Duryodhan ke baare mein baat kyun ki? Pandavas ke baare mein charcha kyun nahi ki? So Acharya has explained that the Sanjaya wanted to console Duryodhan, console Dhritarashtra. Chinta mat karo, tumhara beta tumse bhi jyada dheet hai. Jaise tum nahi sunne wale, samajhne wale, 700 shlok sunne ke baad bhi वो भी नहीं सुनने वाला समझने वाला वो हटी है वो लड़के रहेगा एंड दैट्स द रीजन ही गिव्स द डिस्क्रिप्शन ऑफ व्हाट दुर्योधन डिड इमेजिन इफ संजय वुड हैव गिवन द डिस्क्रिप्शन व्हाट ही गिव्स द डिस्क्रिप्शन व्हिच विल रीड अहेड ऑफ व्हाट पांडवास डिड धृतराष्ट्र वुड हैव कमिटेड सुसाइड एंड यू वुड एग्री व्हाई व्हेन द वे संजय बिगिंस टू डिस्क्राइब व्हाट पांडवास डिड लिटरली एंड वेरी टैक्टफुली ही मेक्स अ मैसेज वेरी क्लियर My dear sir, my dear king, you have no opportunity to win the war. And he gives multiple signs and symptoms of how Pandavas would be victorious. Agar socho wo pehle bata deta, to heart attack aata nahi aata. Isliye thoda, you know, jor ka jhatka dheere se dene, fanta ka ad aaya karta tha na shayad koi. So like that, he holds on to describing what Pandavas did. He talks about what Duryodhan did. So, it's not time for me to read the translation here. In essence, what Duryodhan does, seeing, you know, Krishna, seeing the Pandavas, how great in terms of a sinful person a person may be, still that person always have some amount of guilt feeling. Do we have that experience whenever we do something wrong? Somewhere within our heart we get that pinching, ki kuch toh main galat kar raha hun, yes or no? And it creates an environment of certain amount of insecurity. Agreed? Similarly, a certain amount of insecurity was created in the heart of Duryodhan. Materially, there was no reason for Duryodhan to be scared. Duryodhan got so scared that he walked up to his army officials and the heads and he started instigating them. Instigating means he started, you know, tempting them. Show your loyalty to the throne of Hastinapur. This is the time that we have waited for so long. These are the conspirators. These are the culprits who are trying to attack and take our throne, throne of our great king Dhritarashtra. All of you have been surviving on the money paid by the king. Now it's a time for you to live by your dharma of Kshatriya. Like that he began to instigate and talk to many, many generals. That's how the description comes. But why he had to do that? Pandavas does not do like that. Very strange and bizarre. Just to tell you what's happening on the battlefield. Duryodhan has 11 Akshahani Sena. The calculation of the infantry in those days was given in Akshahani. To give you a quick summary of what one Akshahani means, it means around 1 lakh approximately soldiers on foot, around 25,000 soldiers on elephants, almost that much amount of soldiers on the horses, and so forth. So somewhere around approximately 2 to 3 lakh soldiers are there with different, you know, elephants, horses and so forth. Now Duryodhan has far greater resources than Pandavas. Still he's scared. He has 11 Akshahani Sena. Pandavas only has 7 Akshahani Sena, which means 4 less. And if you multiply 4 by 3, which means they have 12,000 less soldiers and to that degree, less elephants and the horses and so forth. And the elephant and horses in this kind of a war makes a lot of difference. On top of it, Duryodhan have generals in his army, those who could never be defeated. It's declared by destiny that they can never be defeated. Suppose samjho samne wale se yudh lad rahe ho, jisko tum kabhi harai nahi sakte ho, nirash kisko hona chahiye? Us party ko ya is party ko? Pandava should be discouraged, but Duryodhan is discouraged. He has Bhishma Pitama. Nobody can kill him. Kar lo ladai. What will you fight with a person who you could not kill? And that person is so powerful. With a single arrow, he can just wipe out almost half of the Akshahani Sena. And that's how he became so angry on the 9th and the 10th day. Bhishma Pitama was killing the generals or the top leaders of the Pandavas, just like, you know, you sometimes a child step on the ants and they kill. Just so simply, nobody was able to face Bhishma Pitama. Similarly, there was Dronacharya. He also had the boon that he could never be defeated by anyone. Similarly, there was Kripacharya, there was Ashwathama. One after one, there were so many great generals or the great fighters available in the side of Duryodhan. Why was he still fearful? Isn't that a big question? You have everything with you. Actually, that's the irony. When you have everything, that is the time when we become the most fearful. Isn't it? Look around, the more money, the more wealth the person has, the more fearful that person is. The more academic qualifications the person has, the more fearful he is that someone else may rise above me, may get more academic qualifications. You would have quite a good idea in the corporate environment about it. So the lesson here is, material security and resources does not guarantee success and fearlessness. Unfortunately, all our aim in life is to acquire more. Parents se puchiye bachcho ka kya udeshya hai, kya banana chahte hain, unko adhik se adhik padhana hai. But they never talk about character. Character is hardly talked about it. And last time we talked about it, caliber versus character. Bhagavad Gita cannot be understood by a person who thinks he has a caliber. Even if somebody is uneducated, a pauper, even if his body is deformed, even if he cannot read, but if he has a character, Krishna would bestow that wisdom. You cannot demand this knowledge to be released to you. It's unlocked. And we talked about what was a password. What was a password? What was a password to unlock the secret of Bhagavad Gita? Bhaktya so hime sakha cheti. Only my devotee or a friend, who I call as a devotee or friend, not who you say. Ki main Bhagwan ka bahut bada bhakt. No. Lord says, who I call that person as my devotee and as my friend, that person knows the secret of Bhagavad Gita. And that's how this whole journey goes on. So Duryodhan had all the resources, yet he was fearful. Yet he was so doubtful he would win. And because he had made the wrong choices, because he had the selfish motivations, although he had the huge army, because everyone was carrying their selfish motivation to be part in that war, before the beginning of the war or the conflict began between the party of Duryodhan. You know that? There was a conflict, and one of the great fighters said, unless this great fighter dies, I will not come on the battlefield. Just imagine. तुम्हारे पार्टी के लोग कह रहे हैं जब तक हमारे पार्टी के लोग नहीं मारे जाते तब तक मैं युद्ध लड़ने नहीं आऊंगा. दिस इज व्हाट टीम स्पिरिट. जीत लो. यू नो इमेजिन यू आर प्लेइंग अ क्रिकेट मैच, यू नो इंडिया पाकिस्तान फाइनल, एंड यू हैव टू बैट्समैन एंड द अदर बैट्समैन सेइंग मैं नहीं भागूंगा, एंड यू हैव टू ओवर्स रिमेनिंग, यू हैव लेस देन 30 रन टू विन, एंड ही सेज तू 6 बॉल खेल, मैं 6 बॉल खेलूंगा, मैं नहीं भागूंगा, तुझे जितने रन मारने मार. एंड वो कह रहे हैं तू भागना नहीं, मैं नहीं भागूंगा. परफेक्ट टीम स्पिरिट, इजंट इट? टीम विल डेफिनेटली विन. So Karna was boasting about his strength. Skipping the details, I'll keep it pretty concise. He was boasting about his strength. How great I am, I can defeat everyone. Duryodhan, don't worry, you have a great warrior like me by your side and so forth. And Bhishma Pitama was standing there. He said, you fool, you rascal, you're like a cockroach. I'm just paraphrasing it. You are the same person who ran away from the battlefield multiple times when you had to face Arjuna. You are the same person who ran away when Gandharvas kidnapped Duryodhan. You got utterly defeated by them. You are the same person who got defeated when there was a conflict between you and Arjuna face to face. You are the same person when at the end of the incognito war, when we all went and we didn't know the other side was Arjuna, Arjuna single-handedly in an incognito as a eunuch defeated all of us, and you were the first one to run away. And you say that you will defeat Arjuna? What will you defeat? Now, Kshatriyas are highly passionate. हमको ही कोई कुछ छोटा मोटा कह दे तो कैसा हमारा खून उबल जाता, तो सोचो क्षत्रिय का क्या होगा. And Karna said, enough is enough. ये क्या समझते हैं अपने आप को बूढ़े, मतलब बड़े हुए तो क्या हुआ. इनका दिमाग खिसक गया है. आई वुड नॉट कम इन द वॉर दुर्योधन अंटिल दिस ओल्ड मैन इज स्टैंडिंग ऑन हिज चैरियट. अंटिल दिस मैन डाई आई वुड नॉट कम ऑन द बैटल फील्ड. बेचारा दुर्योधन, ये क्या चल रहा है भाई, मेरी पार्टी के आदमी हो, युद्ध लड़ रहे हो. ही नोज वेरी वेल, दुर्योधन नोज वेरी वेल, ही कैन नॉट विन द वॉर विदाउट कर्ण and he also cannot win the war without Bhishma. But he knows one thing, if he does not have Karna, he can definitely never win the war. Why? Because Bhishma always had the soft heartedness or the soft side towards Pandava. In the beginning only Bhishma Pitama said, my dear Duryodhan, I'll fight with all valor, but I would not kill the five sons of Pandu. Karlo fight. Karna to already chala gaya. And the other person who could kill the sons of Pandu, what Bhishma, he says, I would fight, but I would not kill the sons. Now, if you cannot kill the sons of Pandu, well, the war would never end. Nah. You have Bhishma Pitama, who can never die. You have Pandavas, nobody is willing to die, and nobody is willing to kill them. So it's an incessant war which keeps on going. And Duryodhan, he's eager, he's desperate to get these people wipe off from the surface of earth. He's just waiting that these five sons to be killed. Because his headache from his childhood was this five sons of Pandu. And now in the beginning of the war, everyone said, wo paanch nahi marenge, jitna yudh karna hai kar lo. He was still in anxiety. And that's how he's fearful, he's in anxiety, what's going on. And that's how it begins. And that goes up to verse number 12, and then verse number 13 onwards. The description, Sanjay begins to talk about Pandavas. Now, when we see that discussion from verse number 13, you see nowhere Pandavas are by any means at all fear. Not at all. Now, if you think that Arjuna got fearful, that's the reason he said he would not fight, that's not correct. We'll see the reasons that he gives. Isn't it interesting? Duryodhan have all the resources, all the strength. Pandavas are quite weak. Yet they are fearless. Why? We didn't complete the question. I just talked about Duryodhan's side. Let's talk the other side. What gave strength to Pandavas because of which they were fearless? Okay. I don't know if I would like to ask you, you should raise your hand or not, but if you want to. Or maybe we can raise hand. I know 100% answer will be there. How many of you think the fear is a challenge in my life? Fear, bhai. You know? किसी का मृत्यु होने का हुआ है, किसी की जॉब छूटने का, भाई इट्स अ बिग फैक्टर. देयर आर 10 काइंड्स ऑफ फियर्स. आई एम नॉट डिस्कसिंग देयर, आई विल सेंड इट एज अ नोट. इन स्क्रिप्चर्स देयर आर 10 काइंड्स ऑफ भाई दे आर टॉक्ड अबाउट. इंटेंशनली आई स्किप्ड इट, अदरवाइज एट द एंड ऑफ द डे आई वुड हैव गॉट अ कमेंट. प्रोज इट वॉज अ वेरी हॉरिफिक क्लास. हमें अभी तक एक भाई पता था, आपने 10 सुना दिए. सो आई थॉट आई वुड नॉट टॉक अबाउट इट, आई विल गिव यू एज अ नोट, यू रीड इट फॉर योरसेल्फ, सो यू डोंट बिलीव मी दैट आई स्केयर्ड यू. सो व्हाट आर वी टॉकिंग अबाउट? Yeah. So it's a disease. Do you all agree? It's just like a virus fever. You know, it keeps, you know, spoiling our health, and fear keeps spoiling our mental health. How many of you do you agree that if we become fearless, life would be phenomenal? Isn't it? Truly, we can truly live our life. Learn a lesson from Pandavas now. So that's how this discussion becomes important. What made Pandavas fearless? Yet they did not have resources. When Duryodhan looked at the army, and when he looked among the army, Krishna was a, you know, kind of a singular point which was kind of highlighting the most. When he looked at Krishna, he thought, ye kya karega? Arjuna kitna murkh hai. When he and I had an opportunity, Arjuna chose Krishna. Now, and he began to think, what would I do if I would have got Krishna? Main karta kya iske sang? Because he took a vow that he would not pick any weapon. Then he's a useless fellow. This is what Duryodhan was thinking for Krishna. Whereas for Arjuna, he was willing to compromise, or they call it as an exchange. He was willing to exchange even 7 Akshahani Sena, if there was a need for it, for Krishna. For him, what mattered was Krishna by his side. For Duryodhan, that was not the matter. And that's the reason Duryodhan was so fearful. Why? Because he thought he is the boss of all bosses. For Arjuna, he knew he ain't the boss. He is dependent on the mercy of Krishna. Making sense? I'll give you a small story to make it more clear. So one day, one cowherd man took some cows and he took his cows for grazing in the forest. उसी समय जंगल में बहुत बड़ा आंधी तूफान आया, जिसके कारण एक गाय उस हर्ड में से अलग होकर जंगल में चली गई. एंड शी लॉस्ट ट्रैक. एंड आफ्टर अ व्हाइल व्हेन शी वेंट इनसाइड द फॉरेस्ट एंड व्हेन शी लुक्ड अराउंड द रेस्ट ऑफ द काउज वर नॉट देयर, शी वाज प्रीटी स्केयर्ड. एंड सडनली शी हर्ड अ लाउड रोरिंग ऑफ अ लायन. She got terrified and she looked behind. A lion was standing just behind her, looking, gazing at her, making it very clear, you're going to be my lunch today. And when Ka saw that, she got so terrified and petrified, she started running in any direction to save herself. And the lion was chasing, the cow was running, and the lion was chasing, and the lion was almost about to catch hold of the rear end of the cow. Cow, knowing that there is no other opportunity, she tried her best and she jumped. There was some kind of a small hillock and she jumped and she fell on the ground. Unfortunately, it was a quicksand. She went in the quicksand, and when you get into the quicksand, daldal, she started sinking in. And because she leaped, the lion also leaped. And when the lion leaped, he also fell where? In the quicksand. So now that lion is sinking in the quicksand, and now the cow is sinking in the quicksand. And lion, the death personified for the cow, is standing in front of the cow and roaring at the cow, making it very clear, I am going to kill you and rip you apart. And the more the lion was trying to, now the cow is not able to move, nor the lion, but the lion is making all his endeavor to approach the cow. And the more endeavors he makes, the more faster he's sinking in. The lion is getting, you know, he's in full anxiety, he's in full stress. And he looks at the cow, and cow is smiling and very peaceful. And he's too bewildered. Just like many times, you know, you meet people out and they look at devotees and say, Tum log kaise itne khush rehte ho? You know, I've told you that example. One of our devotees works in a bank in London. His manager got really frustrated one day. He said, 3 saal se tu mere andar kaam kar rahe hai. आज तक खुश नहीं रहा, तू 3 साल हमेशा खुश नजर आता है, मैनेजर मैं हूं तेरा, तू क्यों इतना खुश है? Then he said, come, I'll take you to a temple, I'll show you the secret. So many times people ask, why devotees are so happy? And that's what the message this cow gave. She said, my dear sir, you may be the king of this jungle. You think you're the boss of all bosses? Now call for help. Do you think anyone is going to come for your help? You are the person who have climbed, who have become the king of this jungle by killing all other animals. You are envious of every other animal in this jungle. Nobody would come to your rescue. You are so proud and arrogant, you think you are the supreme controller. The lion said, okay, well, I understand, but why are you so happy? The cow said, well, that's not the case with me. I have a master. And my master, the cowherd man, when he finds out that I am missing, then he would come in the jungle to find me. वो मुझे जंगल में ढूंढता हुआ आएगा, और जैसे ही वो मुझे खोजता हुआ आएगा, मुझे पाएगा, he will find me, he will rescue me. And that point of time, she heard the sound of a cowherd man calling for her name, and she also responded back. The cowherd man came, he pulled the cow out. Now both the cowherd man and the cow are out of the quicksand, and they both are looking at that sinking lion. The lion is still sinking, and still he's thinking. तू रुक जरा, मैं बाहर निकलता हूं, खाऊंगा तेरे को. एट दैट पॉइंट ऑफ टाइम ही सैंक इनटू दैट क्विकसैंड. सो दिस लायन रिप्रेजेंट्स दैट फुलिश जीवा और एरोगेंट लिविंग एंटिटी, जस्ट लाइक दुर्योधन, हु थॉट आई एम द कंट्रोलर ऑफ द डेस्टिनी, नॉट ओनली ऑफ माइंड, ऑफ एवरीवन. बिकॉज ही थॉट ही इज अ सुप्रीम कंट्रोलर, दैट बिकेम द कॉज ऑफ हिज एंग्जाइटी. Arjuna is represented by a cow. He said, I am no one, I am dependent. All my strength, all my caliber, everything is given to me. Even the single breath that we are breathing right now is a gift of the Lord. He recognized it, and that's the reason he was fully dependent on Krishna, just like a cow on the master. So cow was peaceful even in that tribulation. Similarly, Arjuna was peaceful or fearless at that critical hour of the life in the battlefield. And that's how we become fearless. And that is what we'll learn ahead in Bhagavad Gita. Krishna says, Veet rag bhaye krodha. Raga is attachment, bhaye is fear, krodha is anger. And he gives a secret formula to give it. I have already told you what's the secret formula. He gives more details that we'll see ahead. Is it all clear now? Why Arjuna was fearless? So that's how about was it? So the lesson from this incident. Anyone would like to read it? That's it. Faith is not a binary number. I have, I don't have. No, it's not like that. Faith is like something, you know, it exponentially increases. वो कब इंक्रीज होता है? जितना हमें अपना मास्टर, just like for a cow and a master, उनका संबंध ज्ञान, means their relationship becomes stronger. And for a relationship to become stronger, you need to know about that person. You need to associate with that person. Yes or no? How can cow have such a faith the master would come? Because she had associated with the master for long enough to know that master also loves me. So unless we have that relationship with Krishna, unless we have cultivated that knowledge about who Krishna is, and to the degree we have that knowledge, to that degree our faith is increased. So that's how to that degree we become fearless. Someone else, next point. Yes, Krishna is always present. He is omnipresent. He is present in the heart of every living entity as Paramatma, Super Soul. If only we recognize He is there, He is willing to help us. Who has the mic? So, it's a very beautiful poem written by one Dutch writer. So, I would like one of you to read it out loudly on the mic, which conveys this message very clearly. Where is the mic? Someone would like to read it? They can just raise their hand and Pranjal will give the mic. Pranjal, Rahul is here. Please read out.
I and God are walking on the sands of the time, and on this sand I saw two sets of footprint, one of mine, another of God. As I see these two footprints, I get immense amount of faith in God being with me. Then suddenly time changes. The ocean goes through high tides and there are massive waves and downpours. The difficult times have now begun. This ocean becomes boiling. There are dark, ominous clouds in the sky, thunder, lightning. I then suddenly start seeing only one set of footprints. I then wondered, how is that in good times? God always walked with me, hand in hand, close to each other, and now the times have changed, things have become difficult, and God has left me. Why did you left me,
God? It's a very beautiful prayer, a poem. It really represents the faith of a conditioned person. Faith which is not complete, partially. A faith based on sentiments, not on knowledge. Go ahead.
Why did you leave me, God? Then suddenly God replies, my dear son, I haven't left you. This one set of footprint that you see is mine, and I picked you up and carried you through the rough times. I knew you would not be able to walk through these times, and hence I walked with you in my arms. And this set of footprints which you see are mine not yours.
And not yours. This is called faith. Good for him, the God spoke to him. And through Bhagavad Gita, Krishna is speaking to each one of us for all the time to come. And there are so many verses where Krishna directly, even in this chapter, you will see how Krishna is introduced, not as a king of the world, not as a supreme personality of Godhead, but as a servant of his devotee, as a chariot driver. Can you imagine? You all would have seen Hollywood and Bollywood movies. And how do you see a hero enters? You know, I don't know, it's a long time, but, you know, long ago they used to see, you know, hero ka entry kaise dikhate the? Camera shuru hota tha uske shoes se. Then dheere dheere badhte hue upar jata tha. Slow motion mein. You know, and you know, idhar angle, udhar angle karte hue. Aur Rajnikant jaisa hua to kuch head bhi uda deta tha hawa mein. And then suddenly the hero would enter. Like that. Now our hero, the real hero, does not enter like that. Our real hero enters like a simple charioteer. waiting to receive orders from his devotee. And this is what the beauty of Bhagavad Gita. This is how incredibly Krishna reciprocates. So we talked about D, Duryodhana and Dhritarashtra, first 1 to 12. Now O represents ominous results. I'll give you the summary of it. Ominous results refers to here. Now Sanjaya begins to answer the second part of the question asked by Dhritarashtra. What did the sons of Pandu do? And now he begins to talk about how the Pandavas, you know, they blew their conch and so forth. And that's where I said, if you read this set of verses, you will notice nowhere Pandavas seem to be in fear. Bhishma in the 12th verse blows his conch. And when he blows his conch, Pandava side begins to blow their conch. And there's a big trumpet and horns and so forth. And they're so happy now the war is going to happen. Pandavas are rejoicing. Only Duryodhana is worried. So here in this section, the key theme, as I said, I would have to summarize a few things. In this section, the key theme is Lord's protection to his devotees. And how Lord's protection to his devotees is shown? In this section, Sanjaya talks about different signs of victory. As I told you in the beginning, right? When Sanjaya begins to talk about Pandus, he talks about how Pandavas would be victorious, O Dhritarashtra, not your sons. And these are some of the signs of victory that Sanjaya narrates to Dhritarashtra. First thing, he was a religious place, which Dhritarashtra himself agreed. Second, main point is Krishna as Rishikesha and Madhava. Rishikesha means the controller of the senses, not only his senses, controller of the senses of everyone, including of Arjuna. Although apparently it seems Krishna is taking directions as a charioteer. No, he is the Rishikesha. He is the one who is controlling the senses of Arjuna. That's just a pastime which is relayed out. And that's how when you go into the 11th chapter, universal form, there when Krishna shows his Virat Roop, Arjuna gets scared. He sees every the personal army personnel standing on the war entering into the ferocious mouth of the Virat Roop. And Arjuna gets totally terrified and he asks, my dear Lord, what's happening? And then Lord resumes his two-headed form. Then he says, my dear Arjuna, don't worry. Become nimitta matram. Become an instrument of my mercy. I have already killed everyone on both sides of the army. You don't have to do anything. But yet he performs a pastime where he is showing to all of us that he is willing to take a humble role of a charioteer. Madhava means a husband of goddess of fortune. So if you have a husband of goddess of fortune, you means you have all the auspiciousness also. So that's how Sanjaya said, Madhava is present there, which means all auspiciousness is on the side of Pandavas. Then the armor and the paraphernalia of Arjuna was discussed, like the chariot which he received from Indra and so forth. Blowing of conch shells, very interesting. In the 19th verse, when you read, Sanjaya says, Jaise hi Pandavas ne apne conch shells blow kare, Kaurava's heart got shattered into pieces. Everyone on the side of the Kauravas got terrified, hearing the loud sound of the conch shell. But Sanjaya never says, when the Kauravas blew their conch shell, anything happened to Pandavas. Nothing happened. And like this, he describes to Dhritarashtra, subtly yet tactfully, Tum harewe ho. You know, you're wasting your time. You're going to lose all your sins like that. And another aspect he mentions is presence of Hanuman on the chariot of Arjuna and the flag. And same Hanuman fought on behalf of Lord Ram and victorious. So Hanuman also represents a symptom of victory. It will happen. Next section, D-O-U. U stands for uncertainty, which is from verse number 21 to 27. Now at this point of time, Arjuna, maybe we can read one verse. Let's go to verse number 22. Verse number 21 and 22 of chapter 1. Arjuna vacha. Now Arjuna is speaking this to Krishna. And he tells Krishna something. And he says, Senayorubhayormathye Ratham sthapayame achyuta. Kindly note achyuta. Arjuna has called Krishna as achyuta for a purpose. I would refrain from giving you the meaning. Note, take it as a homework. If it's your copy of Bhagavad Gita, please circle it and read the purport to find out what is the meaning of Achyuta and why Arjuna said Krishna as Achyuta in this time. Yavadeta senayorupayor madhye ratham sthapayami Achyuta yavadeta nirakshaham yodukaman avasthitan kairmaya saha yodhavyam asmin rana samudyame. So Arjuna says, Senayor Ubhayor Madhye, hey Krishna, Sena ke beech mein jaakar, mere rat ko Sena ke beech mein le jao. Kya karna hai? Ratham sthapya mein Achyuta, mere rat ko sthapit kar do, dono Sena ke beech mein. Kyun? Yavad eta nirakshayam, taki nirakshay means I can observe who has come to fight on the behalf of Kauravas. In other words, I want to see who all I have to kill by my own hands. What is the name of this chapter? Observing the armies. I'll tell you why it is called observing the armies in a brief time. Very important message for all of us. Okay, so that's how Arjuna tells, take my chariot, and Krishna takes his chariot. See, if you see Krishna, he's never standing straight. So don't expect things to come easy. All right? You know, if you see Lord Ram standing straight and so forth, Krishna, you know, is like Teda. So he does what is best for you. He doesn't does what is desired by you. What did Arjuna desire? Take my chariot in between. But what did Krishna do? He did what was best for Arjuna. And what he did? He took his chariot where? Let's read that verse. Let's read verse number 25th. Now where did Krishna brought Arjuna's chariot? Bhishma Drona Pramuktaha. This is first chapter, 25th verse. Sarvesham cha mahishitam.
Sarvesham cha mahishitam.
Vacha partha pasyetan.
Vacha partha pasyetan.
Samvetan kurun iti.
Samvetan kurun iti.
So Krishna, among everybody in the such a huge army, lakhs and lakhs of soldiers on the side of Kauravas, Bhishma Drona Pramuktaha. Pramukh. Kiske samne laake khada kar diya? Bhishma and Drona. Bhishma is a family member. Drona is a teacher. Similarly, in the life of a devotee, we face these two great challenges. What are those two challenges? Challenge posed by our own family members on the path of bhakti. And the second challenge which we face, which is created by us, is our own accomplishments and achievements that make us feel very proud. You getting it? And as soon as Arjuna's chariot was brought in front of Bhishma, seeing Bhishma, his great-grandfather, the familial relationship, the love for his great-grandfather, evoked in his heart, and he started to shake. And that's where the downfall of Arjuna happens here now. When he saw Dronacharya, he realized, he's my teacher who taught me everything. He started to shake. How can I fight with them? And this is not the fight which would end without killing. This is the ultimatum. Somebody has to die. And he knew very well, because Krishna is by my side, they cannot kill me. So he knew, because Krishna is by my side, they both would be killed. And they would be killed by my hands. Similarly, in the life of a practicing sadhaka or a devotee, it's a challenge that we all face of family. At times, family would discourage us, ki kya kar rahe ho tum? Itni bhakti karne ki kya avashyakta hai? Ek bar, ek ladke ne, naujawan tha wo, usne dhrad nishchay kara ki main apna jeevan Bhagwan ki seva mein lagaunga. And he came to our temple and he joined our temple long ago. Then suddenly his parents got to know ki unka ladka missing kaha hai, iskon mein hai, pahunch gaya iskon mein, puri family ko lekar. Hamare ladke ko wapis karo. Haan ji sir, le jaiye. Kya kar rakha hai usko? Naujawan hai abhi. Ye koi samay hai iska ye sab karne ka? जब वो मेरी एज का हो जाए तब उसको आश्रम में लेना, मुझे कोई प्रॉब्लम नहीं है। तो जो भक्त सुन रहा था तो उन्होंने कहा ठीक है सर, आप बेटे को ले जाओ, यू ज्वाइन। He was taken aback. He said, ask my wife. Wife said, you rascals, get lost from here. पहले बेटे पे नजर डालिए, मेरे पति पे नजर डाल रहे हो, चलो यहां से सब। Jokes about it, it's a true story, it happened like that. You know? So, nonetheless, we all face challenge. Depends. Do we act like Krishna or how we act? Or do we act like Arjuna? What did Arjuna do? Arjuna was also troubled. Right in the beginning of the second chapter, he surrendered. My dear Lord, I don't know. Shishya seham sadimam tvam prapannam. I surrender unto you. Whatever you say, I'll do it. And look what happened. Was Bhishma Pitama upset from Arjuna? No. Same Bhishma Pitama told Yudhishthira Maharaj how to kill him. Same Bhishma Pitama, when he saw Yudhishthira Maharaj at the end, see, wearing the throne, or that, what they call, crown of Hastinapur, he was so happy. And it's a practical example. Yes, even my parents were pretty upset about it. It's just a matter of time. When they see the sincerity and when they understand what it is, they not only acknowledge and appreciate, even they join. Even they really join and they begin to serve, because they also recognize this is the best thing that we can do for ourselves. And they, many times they become, the parents themselves become the biggest inspiration for a child to continue on the path of bhakti. Maybe I can give an example. There was one brahmachari in some temple who used to struggle a lot in getting up early in the morning. सबने अटेम्प्ट करा उसको समझाने का कि समय पे उठा करो, हमेशा लेट हो जाता था मंगल आरती के लिए। एक दिन घर पे गया, माँ बाप बहनों ने सबने पकड़ के उसको इतना सुनाया, भगवान की सेवा में लग गया है, वापिस मत आ जाइयो। They chastised so much, you are doing the best thing, we are wasting our life here. What are you doing? Why are you not taking advantage of your life? You've already dedicated it to the 100%. And trust me, the day when he came back from his trip visiting his parents, from that day onward, he never got late for Mangal Aarti. Nobody could correct him. But his parents became, his sister became the major source of inspiration which inspired him to perform bhakti. And the same parents were fighting initially. Kyo kar diya aise hamare bachche ke saath? And it's with everyone. And as you all begin your journey, you will have to face a little bit of tribulations from your family members, relatives. अरे ये कोई एज है, अभी तो नौजवान हो, थोड़े बड़े हो तो बोलेंगे क्या कोई एज है, अभी तो बच्चे छोटे हैं, थोड़े और बड़े हो जाओगे तो बोलेंगे ये कोई एज है, बच्चों की भी तो शादी करनी है, फिर थोड़े और बड़े हो जाओगे ये कोई एज है, ग्रैंडसन को भी तो देखना है, आगे कहने के लिए वो बचेंगे नहीं। You have reached up to the level of yourself becoming a grandfather. Of course, they have winded up their business and they moved on. You know, but that's what people keep saying. Question is, what do we decide with that? So the key theme is Lord as an intimate servant of his devotee. You'll find here how Krishna is introduced. I'm skipping that verse, and you will see Krishna is introduced as sitting on a chariot of Arjuna. Let's move ahead. And we already discussed about this verse. So D-O-U and B, the fourth section, is bewilderment. Verse number 28 to 30. Bewilderment means confusion. Ab uski buddhi sahi tarike se soch nahi pa rahi hai. Ya ye kahiye ki now Arjun ka jo drad nishchay tha yudh karne ka, jo itne saalon se usne drad nishchay banaya rakha tha, ab wo kamzor hota ja raha hai. So here, 28 to 30, again, read it as a homework. I'll give you the synopsis. We're running out of time now. So the key theme is, why Arjuna got bewildered? Very important purpose. Kindly note it down. Read it for yourself. The main thing is, illusion causes all problems in life arising due to bodily identification. He immediately came onto the bodily platform. He started seeing people in terms of bodily identification. What is that illusion that arises from bodily identification? Which means me, which means I, and mine, that is connected to my body. Because he saw my grandfather, Bhishma Pitama, that's a body identification. My teacher, Dronacharya, because of seeing that, he forgot his duty, his dharma that he had to perform. And he got bewildered. And the last section of doubt, T for turning point. Now, at this point of time, Arjuna, after losing his determination to fight, in this section he gives reasons to justify to Krishna that why I should not fight. How many times it happens in our own life? When we are undergoing a problem, we ourselves come up with a solution. Rarely I have seen people seeking genuine advice or solution. I deal with this kind of a counseling a lot. The more immature the person would be, the more that person thinks that he knows for himself. When he comes to us, or when he comes to anyone for that reason, if anyone is senior and has some understanding of subject matter, when he shares his heart, the idea of that person is not to seek solution. It's just to tell you, this is what my problem is, and this is what my solution is. Be happy. So he just comes to convey that message. And if you look at Arjuna right now, he's also doing the same thing. He's not letting Krishna to speak. He's got so much covered over by illusion. And to mind you, Arjuna is not covered over by illusion. I clarified that point in the last session, right? Why Arjuna got into this situation? Krishna brought him into this situation so that Bhagavad Gita could be spoken. Yada yadahi dharmasya glanir bhavati bharataha. युद्ध के द्वारा ही केवल धर्म की स्थापना नहीं हो पाती. उनको भगवद गीता बोलनी थी ताकि आगे आने वाली अनेक सदियों के लिए, पीढ़ियों के लिए भगवद गीता का ज्ञान उनको दिया जा सके. That's the reason Krishna created that illusion for Arjuna. And Arjuna is representing an ordinary living entity who struggles like this. And the more mature a person would be when he goes to discuss, like Arjuna would show his maturity in the second chapter. At that time, he's just not sharing his problem. He's looking for a solution. Are you seeing the difference? The more mature person is, he thinks, I know what's the solution also. Well, if you know the solution, then apply it, be happy. Yet, that person would not be happy. But still, he would not take advice. Of course, to whom to take advice is a different subject matter. We cannot go and ask anyone and everything about everything. The person also needs certain qualifications. Those qualifications are mentioned in the fourth chapter of Bhagavad Gita. We'll see at that point of time. So here, Arjuna begins to speak his mind. And he gives five arguments. First, compassion. My dear sir, or my dear Krishna, he says, we shouldn't fight because I would be killing my dear and beloved people. Feeling of compassion for friends and relatives. How can I kill my seniors and elders and friends and relatives? As kind of a compassion which he exhibits. Lord would refute these arguments in second chapter, verse number 11 to 13. Compassion arising from illusion would be counteracted by the knowledge of soul. Because he's considering it on the platform of body, then Krishna argues or refutes this argument of his by talking about that we are not the body but the soul. We'll see that later on. Second argument is enjoyment. From verse number 30 to 35, Krishna, if I win, I lose. If I lose, I lose. You got it? Didn't get it. Let me tell you. Which means, just like a very strong material way of living, which is what? People want to acquire more, not to necessarily enjoy. By showing more, they like to gratify. Yes or no? So Arjuna is saying, if I win, if I acquire my kingdom back, who would I show my opulence? No, none of my relatives would survive. Everyone would die. So main kisko dikha ke ye mehsoos karunga, dekho main kitna mahan hoon. So he says, if I win, I lose. And if I lose, I lose. Anyways, I would lose. So Prabhupada's purpose for this section is very important. Do read it if you get time. Blind conception of life, that is not knowing how to achieve even material happiness. And Lord will refute this argument in second chapter, verse number 31 to 32. The third argument, fear of sins, is a very important section where, you know, Prabhupada writes in a purport that every single argument of Arjuna is valid and is shastric. Shastras say like that. But in one section, in this particular section from 35 to 38 verse, at least take this as a homework, Prabhupada talks about transcendental duty and mundane duty. Mundane duty or transcendental duty ke andar kya difference hota hai? Arjuna got victimized by the idea of mundane duty. So he was speaking on the behalf of Karmakanda scriptures. And then Krishna talks about transcendental duty from the second chapter onwards. So, fear of sins, royal enjoyment, not worth the karma for killing. Main agar apne bado ko marunga, mujhe sin milega, so I don't want to enjoy it. And Lord will refute in second chapter, verse number 33 to 37. Argument number 4, destruction of family traditions. If I kill the elders, who would protect the traditions? Who would teach the next generation what are our traditions, what are our values? And because traditions would be lost, फिर क्या होगा? अधर्म की स्थापना हो जाएगी. There would not be a man available to protect the woman, because of which woman would get exploited, and that would lead to varna sankara, which means unwanted progeny or child, and because of which it would cause hellish life for a family and society. So, my dear Lord, in this section, Arjuna says, Krishna, Govinda. In this section, he tells us, Madhava, you represent auspiciousness. But if I do so, it will bring inauspiciousness, so I should not do it. Ancestors, which means Pindadan, will get neglected. And community and welfare projects would get stopped. And the destroyer, which means I, because I am destroying all the things, I would have to eternally live in the hell. Now, I would request at this point of time, please open your booklet. I have drawn a chart there. You see this chart, degradation of society, which mentions of this point. At the last tab, you will see present society. You see that? I would request next time, please keep this books handy and so they can open it. In the last tab, you will see present society. Can anyone read out what is written after that? Which is the condition of the present society. Aaj log bolte hain kuch acha nahi chal raha hai, kuch welfare projects nahi to, you know, vatavaran acha raha hai, kuch bhi nahi hai, na khane ke liye achhi cheez reh gayi hai. It's just because of these reasons how the destruction of dynasty happens. And the last argument which Arjuna gives, he would give this argument in the second chapter. So next time I'll talk about it. It's almost time up now. So let's do a quick reflection. And I'll pause here. Maybe I'll give you the lesson, then I'll pause. And then we'll continue next time. What was the cause of Arjuna's bewilderment or a downfall? The cause was not having a clear understanding of one's own self-interest. He saw his self-interest in relationship to bodily identification. And what was the effect of it? Effect was fear, loss of composure, and indecision. And that's how Arjuna, at the end of this chapter, with tears in his eyes, sits down and he puts his Gandiva bow. He says, my dear Krishna, I shall not fight. Srila Prabhupada.
Krishna Krishna Hare 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 Rama Hare
Everyone, please.
Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare.
Hare Krishna,
Krishna Krishna Hare 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 Rama Hare Rama 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 Hare Hare
Krishna Hare Hare